law is because these are the only undisputed facts, the state is unable to prove their case beyond a reasonable doubt. There was a traverse filed in this case. I ruling that traverse does not compel denial of the motion because it doesn't dispute any material facts. The facts are the motion to strike the traverse is correct in that regard. You dispute legal conclusions, which that's what a motion to dismiss sequel motion does. But as far as, for instance, it seems to me your primary contention is that tagging someone, and I'm sure we'll hear a lot about that this afternoon, is directed at the victim. That's a legal conclusion, not a factual conclusion. She admits all the facts and does not dispute any of those facts. So, therefore, the traverse does not compel denial. But I'm moving to deny your motion. I mean, I'm going to deny your motion to strike or traverse and let it stand. Because the fact that you could file the motion to strike indicates that you are prejudiced. And the fact that it's not sworn to isn't necessary because there's no facts she disputes, which is easy to correct anyway. We've done that many times on defendants in our motions. That's very important. The only thing I would say about the motion to dismiss and the traverse is that the controlling case law, there is case law from the second DCA, the third DCA, and the fourth DCA. Your motion indicates that that is not controlling on the court. I beg to differ with that. Pardo versus State, 596, 7 seconds, 664, 1992 case, says in the absence of any decisions from our district court of appeal that trial courts are bound to follow controlling precedent from other circuits. So, there I have been cited, nor have I found any cases from the Fifth exactly on this point. And so, in that situation, uniform cases from other districts would be binding on this court. So that's where we are. You have evidence that you'd like to present, or how would you like to proceed? Is this something like to go to court to legal argument?
Your Honor, we have three witnesses that we have present today that would like to hear their testimony, as well as a composite of many of the defendant's social media posts that if you for you to consider if you wanted to take a look at some of this. A lot of them I included in motion, a lot of weren't, so I didn't know if you wanted to. It's kind of a sort of big packet, as you can imagine, but that's another thing that we have here today.
We do not object to the composite exhibit that contains the social media posts that we referred to. However, I do object to the witnesses testifying as the testimony is irrelevant. We've admitted to the authenticity of the posts and also to the fact that she did make the complaints to the superiors. So there's no facts at issue. This is purely a legal hearing. Also, my understanding is that they are here to testify regarding the substantial emotional distress standard required in the statute, and that is not a subjective standard, it's a reasonable person standard, therefore them testifying has no relevance to that. We can even stipulate that Ms. Margaret, she did feel substantial emotional distress. It's not based on her, it's based on a reasonable standard, so therefore we find their testimony too.
Who are these witnesses and what can you propose them testify to?
The witnesses are Mr. Judge. It's going to be a Sergeant Claudia of the New Smyrna Beach Police Department, a Deputy Chief Jessica Paw of the New Smyrna Beach Police Department, and then the victim in this case, Ms. Taylor Bartolucci. And defense is exactly right in what they just mentioned, that we would like to show the court emotional distress, and then have the court find whether or not it is substantial based on a reasonable person standard. Further, if I may, Your Honor, I'd like to argue that there are material facts in dispute in this case that we're citing to in the traverse that do not contain a legal argument. And just namely, in the first part of the motion dismissed, there's 13A. When we get into the conduct of the defendant, where it starts to mention the allegations and the content of his post, which are the basis for this case, but I'm not here to argue the law, whether a tag or a hashtag, you know, that would be a legal argument. It does say in this the continuing goes B, there are material facts in that say there's posts about being a rape survivor criticizing his Barbara Lynch's post about the Me Too movement. That's simply not true.
Okay, the Me Too is not the facts of it, but when it was in 2011.
Right.
And as I understand, there's some poster that was an unfortunate photograph or poster of some sort.
That's what I understand as well, Your Honor.
Wait, is that really a material fact necessary to your prosecution of this case? Is
no,
just a fact?
But we would move this, well, we'd argue to the court that if this is an undisputed material fact, we'd like the record clear of what the content of these posts actually were.
Right. She doesn't dispute any of those, right?
Well, we will dispute that there's no making posts and criticizing anyone about the Me Too movement. I mean, I don't want to simply stand here and argue the traverse, so I think the court's ready. Just to answer your question, this is what would happen, provided we give live testimony here today. We would hear from Robert Claudio, Sergeant. He was the supervisor of Caleb Bartolucci. He would testify to the events in this case and also the substantial emotional distress that Caleb went through, both knowing her prior to this incident and thereafter. Similarly, Jessica Paul would also testify to the same thing, but in a different facet, not cumulative, but her own experiences with this case. And then, of course, Caleb Bartolucci is here to testify about everything that happened in this case to her.
Okay, she says she's willing to stipulate that it may have caused her substantial emotional distress. That is not the only thing you have to prove, however, is it?
No, Your Honor. We do have to prove that as a specific person, and I think we've done that. I don't think that's a material fact in dispute.
I think that by tagging or calling her Kayla or her using her first name, but social media posts, that's a legal issue.
Yes, sure.
And then there's also the issue of whether it serves a legitimate purpose.
Correct.
So do you not accept her stipulation that it caused this part of which is substantial emotional distress?
If I heard the defense correctly, I believe they were saying, are you stipulating to that she did suffer substantial emotional distress as dictated by the statute?
Her point is this is not subjective.
Yeah, but I wouldn't say it satisfies the statute. I'd say that she considers herself to have experienced substantial emotional distress. I don't deny that. But that's not the standard. It's what a reasonable person in her position would.
Right. And so we were here to seek to show the court that she is a reasonable person and that these events caused her reasonable, substantial emotional distress.
I don't believe that this case is going to turn on that element that you have to prove a rather the other element. She's willing to. The court would so find that it's upset her, and whether or not that upset is sufficient for the statute is not going to be the deciding factor in this case.
Yes, sir.
It's going to be the other elements that are required for the state to prove, any one of which is sufficient.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And additionally, Your Honor, I just wanted to add, I believe the victim's testimony as the social media coordinator could help clear up maybe some questions as to how she was notified via these posts and everything on social media, just to make that clear as part of our argument as to how it was directed at her. And additionally, as to the content of the posts that were made and showing that this would not be the kind of speech that was constitutionally that it would show that it was not serving a legitimate purpose, the content of these posts. I would leave her testimony as to what exactly it was saying, and I included some of it in my in my traverse, but she would have testimony as to that as well.
You can certainly argue or present whatever you choose to, but I would imagine that all of that could be accomplished through Ms. Barnes.
Yes, Your Honor. I believe the only thing I'll leave the court with is we just want you to make the best informed decision you can today.
That's fine. Thanks for the endeavor to do so.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Yes. So, and I'm trying to tell you.
Yes, Your Honor.
So, if you want to, you can present whatever testimony that you choose to, but just so as we're all on the same page here, the things that you have to prove under stalking, we all understand what that is based on the elements, that it's directed at a specific person, that it causes substantial emotional distress, that it is a course of conduct, and serves no legitimate purpose. Not any one of those, but all of those. So.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think she's willing to stipulate that it causes individual substantial emotional distress. As far as if you have something else to add, your office, you plural, have filed not only a statement of particulars in detail prior in this case, but also a traverse, which I have not written. So.
And as far as the other witnesses' testimony, to Your Honor, as far as the emotional distress, Ms. Bartolucci is not the only one to be targeted and opposed by this defendant. So they will have testimony as to how it made other people feel under similar circumstances, which is things to show that it's more than objective view, it's not just her personal feelings. This is something that would affect any reasonable person.
What is her, who is the alleged victim in your information?
Ms. Bartolucci. I'm not trying to say that they're, I'm trying to say that her actions, she's not being unreasonable in her response to these actions. Other people have had similar responses to the same type of conduct.
Well, again, that would seem to be a legal conclusion to me, not a factual one.
If you're hearing from multiple people that they've had similar reactions to the same type of conduct or the defendant, then I think that shows that.
Imagine this lawyer would be willing to stipulate that, but they would specify to me. I mean, I'm sure that the assistant chief has better things to do in the middle of the pandemic.
She's here ready to go and willing to testify, but.
And I would object to hearing from people who are not charged, who are not listed as victims of the information, talking about a possible uncharged crime here if they're claiming to be.
Well, certainly not, but they're, we're not hearing that. So they would be called to testify what they believe a reasonable person would feel under the circumstances?
We'd be calling them to testify to exactly what they observed Kayla Bartolucci's response to these actions. That's what she'd be testifying.
Okay. I think we've stipulated that
right. She
personally has had distress as a result of this several months.
Yes, sir. And I still don't think the defense is willing to concede that that element is satisfied.
Okay. She's right. It's an objective standard. So that she did suffer emotional distress, would it not be a legal conclusion then whether that was reasonable under the circumstances?
You're correct. That would be a legal conclusion.
Okay. So. Don't need factual testimony about it then.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay. One moment to.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
We have a nice big courtroom here. I want everybody to practice social distancing. Remove yourself.
Judge, would you like a copy of the case law before we
get started?
I have a copy.
This one's nice and tight.
Thank you.
Your Honor, if we hear everything that you said today, we would ask that Caleb Barber, would you still be allowed to come testify as to your parents?
Ms. Barber,
April to November, I did not do social media. I had no recollection of it before. I accidentally blocked her. I did notice that she happened to be tagging the police department Twitter over and over again, but it seemed to be the only social media that she was tagging. But after receiving so many of those notifications, I thought in my mind, coming from my experience, that it might actually be a spam bot or a created account because it was the same message over and over again. It was rather vulgar and in regards to something that I wasn't aware of, an issue. In an attempt to mute the notifications to save my own sanity, as I was working a lot of jobs at once, I accidentally blocked her, and I was made aware by her then moving to the Facebook and tagging us.
And you say accidentally blocked her, what were you trying to do?
I was trying to mute the notifications on Twitter. I believe that's an option, because it was just hourly. It seemed very repetitive to the point where I thought it was not a human being. But upon confirming through LinkedIn, which notified her who I was, unfortunately, I did confirm it was a human being, and I thought I blocked her, but I did not. I thought I muted her, but I did block her.
And so when you say, can you explain the part a little bit? I'm not sure how familiar with LinkedIn, Your Honor, is. So about how the notifications work if you review someone else's profile.
Sure. So yeah, I had used this system before previously to check out, you know, candidates or interns that I was working with in previous roles. So LinkedIn can be a good tool to check in professional backgrounds of people. Unfortunately, when you are logged in, it does notify if you're not in private mode, and I was not. It notifies whoever you look at. So when I looked at Ms. March on her account, it notified her that Caleb Luigi Cavaloku, which is my married name, had seen her. So that was the system notified her.
And on your account, did it describe your job title and everything like that?
It did.
So at some point, did Ms. March become aware that you were in charge of the social media accounts?
Pretty much instantly, it seemed. The post that made me aware that I had blocked her was directed at me and talking about the new social media girl, very belittling language, and that I had broken the sunshine law, which I was not aware of.
Can you say directed at you, how these posts reference you?
Right. So while they were tagged to the PD, so the notifications would come up as I was just checking the PD, and then I would see my name. Eventually she would go on to use, I think that day, the first day, she used screenshots of my profile and my face, my full name. And most of the posts were directed as if they were speaking directly to me. A lot were, Caitlin, how are your fucking white feelings going, or the fucking white tears? A lot of just, I just wouldn't want to meet that person kind of language. Just very aggressive, I guess, and angry.
And would she often tag the Smyrna Beach Police Department in these posts?
In every single one, yes, to this day.
And would you get notifications every time that they
spoke? Every single day, yeah. Hourly, I mean, it was a lot, so much that I did choose to speak with my supervisors about it and eventually got removed from it because it was just all about me and my, you know, my life. Nothing to do with, you know, what I was trying to help with the police department.
And as part of your job as a social media coordinator, was it your job to check these posts and read what commenters or people tagging them had to say?
Yes, I do feel like that is part of the social media manager role, is to stay on top of communications, because often I would respond to notifications from other people in our community who had questions or issues. I would direct them in the right place and do what I thought was the right thing to do in that role.
And along with her comments regarding you, would she include any kind of hashtags or anything in her posts?
The hashtags seem to be part of it, eventually using Fire Kayla, Fuck Kayla, Fuck Kayla's White Feelings. It's been 15 months of hashtags, because when you use a hashtag, that allows it to be grouped with other things, so it really exposes it to other markets. So she would use hashtag LoveNSB, which is a city marketing thing, which is supposed to be used for sharing, you know, the tourism side of everything, and everything's happy and go lucky, but when you search that now, you see a lot about fuck Kayla, and it was just another tactic to make it more public.
So just to be clear, if you were to go search, say, the hashtag love NSB on Facebook or Twitter, the post from Ms. March's profile would be
Right. It comes from coding. You want to hashtag everything so it's grouped together, and that is a mechanism of social media. It helps, you know, in the line of work.
In addition to flat out saying your name, did the defendant ever comment on any other personal aspects that made posting as though they were targeting you?
Yeah, she would pretty much anything that she could find. She, you know, really talked about my education and where I'm from in Texas, saying that they should have found someone from Florida for this position, that I was completely unqualified, that my advertising degree was shit. Essentially anything, I mean, to the point where she started mentioning my husband, that he is, you know, half Hawaiian and has brown skin. I mean, it just became so much. And I do have all of my profiles private. I just don't, it just seemed like more and more information. She knew where I lived, she knew where I worked, even after changing jobs, she was able to find me. Yeah.
And were her critiques of you, were they always about your position with the police department, or did they go further?
They went further. There was a lot of body shaming. And just general, what you would assume like a child bully would go. A lot of insecurities were touched on, and that, you know, it's just concerning the amount of information that she was able to collect about me. A lot of physical insults, a lot of educational insults, a lot of that I just shouldn't be here. Just a general, I shouldn't be in my role.
And as far as knowing where you live, at any point did you become concerned that the defendant knew your home address?
Very much so. At some point she did put a map of my house as her cover photo, I guess, saying something about my family being racist or white supremacist for years. And it then progressed from that map to actually a photo, as if you were standing in front of my house. It just got very uncomfortable. And then, yeah.
So the photo, your house wasn't in the picture, correct?
On the map, it was.
I'm sorry, in the photograph that's of the street that you live on.
Right.
Can you describe where that would have been taken from in the angle?
Sure, it's as if you were standing on the sidewalk in front of my house. You know, we have an old 100-year-old house on the corner. We're completely surrounded by a hospital. We're the only house there, actually, which is super weird. But it's as if you were standing on our property. You know, it just, I mean, no one would have realized probably what that was except for us. It's very concerning after seeing your house on a map. And that was after she had started tagging my husband's place of work as well and talking about how he's a white supremacist. It's just very confusing.
So these were other allegations that you were racist or white supremacist and stuff as well.
Mm-hmm.
Did that seem to be a theme throughout
those? It seemed to be that she had had some sort of issue where she already felt like this city was racist. And I just kind of walked in the room.
And when you get tagged in things on social media and in your job position, when you would go and click on a post, would it take you to that person's profile?
Right. Okay. Yes. Which is further concerning because then you could see the volume of everything.
And just moving on from the social media post for a minute, do you know of any other formal complaints about you that the defendant made at your workplace?
Yes, she was very verbose about putting in multiple complaints with the mayor, the commissioners, the chief of police, the deputy chief, the HR director, and I'm not sure how many there were, but most of the time when there was something, she would screenshot it to make sure everyone knew what was said. I tried not to pay attention, and I was never spoken to about these by the city.
So you're not sure how many there were?
I'm not sure.
Do you know if Ms. March attempted to file criminal charges against you at any point?
At one point, in the beginning of all of this, I was notified by the deputy chief that the FDLD was on premises to investigate me because there was an allegation or a complaint made by Ms. March that I was abusing police databases. So I was interrogated for an hour. I did not even know of the databases that were in question, nor did I have access to them. It was decided it was not an accurate complaint, and I was able to receive a full report of that. I was later notified that maybe 6 months later, after I started this process, she had tried again, but the FDLE refused to investigate due to no evidence.
So that initial thing, there was no merit at all?
No merit. I did not have access to any of that.
And are there any other actions of Ms. Marge's that you found concerning that I haven't mentioned?
I've been very concerned by the time. Like, even after pressing charges, it just seemed to escalate in retaliation. So now that there are, I mean, we're all aware of the camera in the room, there are bloggers now. I've received harassing calls at work. That's really just not been helpful in this whole thing. It seems like she has been able to blow this up into something where there are more people that have not the right idea of what actually happened. I've really just been trying to move away from this.
I understand.
Yeah.
So, the Facebook posts, the pictures of your home, the complaints at work, and the attempt to file criminal charges, I'm sure it's made you feel a lot of feelings. Has it scared you?
It's terrified me, especially when it started with my husband. I did file charges as soon as my husband got involved because of my family. I don't have kids or anything, but that really means a lot to me. And then it amplified when it got to my house. I no longer feel safe at my house or at work. I transferred positions because I didn't want to work in the code enforcement department forever. It was really my foot in the door. But even going to leisure services now, it should be a good fit for me. It's not because I'm just not the same anymore. I'm very anxious. I'm very concerned about my safety.
Have you taken any other safety precautions at work, as far as...
Well, I'm moving to a new location. I don't want to really share it. I mean, it's all public record, and I know she'll find out, but it's just... I just don't know what I'm going to do. I am very used to anxiety, since I do have an anxiety disorder, so I've taken steps to seek therapy since it's beginning. I'm a very big fan of therapy, and it's really helped me. Unfortunately, I've had gotten some medications that I haven't been on since 2007, when I was diagnosed with my anxiety disorder. I've lost a lot of weight. My stomach is just not... I have irritable bowel syndrome, as a lot of people do with anxiety. It's really had an effect on me physically and emotionally. I can't sleep. I'm trying.
Mm-hmm. Aside from you accidentally blocking the defendant back in January of last year, have you interacted with her in any way?
No, I have not. I am not engaged in any single way. That is literally the only thing that I've done, and I wish I could go back, and I wish I could just never do that. But no, I am not trying to engage. I've honestly tried to distance, because I don't understand what's happening, and I don't know why I continue to go through this.
Can you pass the water?
That would be really nice. Thank you.
Thank you.
No, I just want to, I just want to know if they accurately reflect the photos that you've seen. Have they been altered in any way that you can tell?
No. They look like what they are.
And what are they exactly using this graphic for?
It just feels like a campaign to make me feel terrified and uncomfortable in the new location.
Are they social media posts by Ms. March?
They are, yes. A lot directed completely at me, like, Kayla, why do you still work there, fam? And then she texts.
Objection, Your Honor. I would object to her reading the posts. They've been entered evidence, Your Honor.
My apologies. There's one more.
The previously marked estate sale will be received in evidence in state's one paper assessment.
That is correct.
These posts were to you started back in January of last year, correct?
Mm-hmm.
How long did they go on for?
They're still going on now. Yeah. It really hasn't stopped. It just seems to have shifted angle what she was allowed a lawyer. She is more of an activist stance now. But it continued. I mean, it's still going on.
Do you have any idea how many posts have been there in video?
I mean, when I reported it to the police department, I had over 400 pages, and that was maybe 2 months or a month. You can only imagine now.
Thank you. And Cross?
Just
one. You need a moment?
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Great.
So just to clarify, when you say the police department was tagged, it was the actual police department that was tagged, not your personal page, correct?
Right. My personal page is private. Okay. There would not be a chance to tag it.
But just to clarify, it was the...
It's the account that I managed, the news information police department.
No further questions.
Redirect on that point?
No, Your Honor.
All right. Your excuse me, wait a second. Other evidence?
No, Your Honor, unless you'd like to hear from further witnesses, which...
Your Honor, the proper, just a condensed version of their testimony. Robert Claudio would testify that the posts made were not in advancing some legitimate purpose where she would be requesting service of the PD or the code enforcement. In fact, she that actually was serviced by the code enforcement and helped by the code enforcement with their removal or placement of a fence. These actions were subsequent to that. So there was no pending request of the defendant on the department to carry out any specific act. Under their purview, and then also their observations of the victim, but I think you got that. And then the other witness would likely just testify her observations of the victim. So,
okay.
If you wish to hear from that, or you feel like that would make a difference in your opinion and your order today, I'd like to present that testimony, but I think it might be cumulative. I'm happy to go my way to court.
Again, this is all about posts that you have in written form here. I don't see how Mr. Claudio can say that there was no legitimate purpose about it. She did have interactions with code enforcement. If we were discussing facts, she would testify as to all of the details of that. But this is, like I said, a legal hearing, and I feel like it's pretty much irrelevant, and the posts as we admitted to them, and the two instances of her reporting her to her supervisors, those are the material facts, and I think they are agreed on. Anything else with your
response to that?
our response would be that the law is well articulated in our motion to dismiss, and we believe it is controlling in this case. We just believe that the facts do rise, and it's, what I'll say now is better safe for the argument portion. Yeah. But we can start that. But these, okay, these witnesses would likely be cumulative for that purpose.
I believe so.
Yes. Yes, Your Honor.
Instructions to prove the crime of stalking, you must prove that
the defendant willfully, maliciously, and repeatedly followed, harassed, or cyberstalked the victim. They define cyberstalk to mean engaging in a course of conduct to communicate or to cause to be communicated words, images, or language by or through the use of electronic mail or electronic communication directed at a specific person, causing substantial emotional distress to that person and serving no legitimate purpose. Now, first, the issue of whether this was directed at a specific person. Now, as we discussed, there is a case that I did not include in my motion, but that was Pardo, the case you discussed at the beginning of this hearing, that does actually say that the case law is controlling out of the other district courts. Now, there's been a couple different cases on it. I will start with Log v. Book. Would you like me to read the citation so we can have a look? In Log v. Book, that included a sex offender law advocate attempting to get a stalking injunction against an opponent of sex offender laws.
Log v. Book is not final, though, right?
No, it is not. Now, social media posts in there were not considered to be cyberstalking because they were not sent directly to the advocate and therefore would not be considered directed at a specific person for the granting of a stalking injunction. Now, in this case, the appellate had posted the home address on his website, as well as pictures of her home, and posted a video with a song containing obscene titles and lyrics. He even tweeted that the song perfectly depicted the appellee. However, the court said that these weren't considered stalking because they weren't sent directly to her. They said that there was no doubt they were aimed at her. However, they found that due to the second and third district's previous case law, a course of conduct does not include social media messages as that type of conduct. Now, in Horowitz v. Horowitz, it was a wife trying to get a stalking injunction against a husband for the protection of cyberstalking. The reasoning included that the wife was not tagged in the post. They distinguished social media posts from email when they said that unlike email communications, which this court considered to be cyberstalking, posts to one's own Facebook page are not directed at a specific person, but are instead posted for all the user's Facebook friends to see, depending on the user's privacy settings. And as testified, none of the posts included a tag for this part of the sheet. In David B. Texter, there's another case in alleged stalking, and there were comments made on electric medium to be read by others, and they agreed that they could not be considered to be directed at a specific person. They said that while social media may reference the alleged victim, either overtly, which in this case it is, or covertly, it's not enough to constitute cyberstalking. They have found that these threats or comments need to be at the individual via delivery, not just their content.
Was there tagging in David versus Texter?
I don't believe. I believe it was posted on a website. Let's see.
There was also tagged Texter's Instagram account with a photo of Hitler and the caption, sorry if I have offended anyone who's tagging neo-Nazis.
Yes.
Does tagging allow any followers of Texter to see the Hitler photo and the caption attached to the petition with emails, Hitler photo, tweets, and by David referencing various, et cetera? So yeah, it did.
Yes. So it did also reference tagging as being one of the kind of hallmarks as to whether it's directed at a specific person in the day of social media where it's so commonly used.
And the court found that that was not sufficient?
Yes. So as we've discussed, while the district or the state Supreme Court has not ruled on this issue, those three district courts have in those cases, specifically stating that social media posts,